Welcome to the Classical Gabfest, a weekly discussion about the ever-changing world of classical music. I'm your host for this week, William White, and with me as always are Tiffany Liu and Kensho Watanabe. This week, we'll be discussing Sir Simon Rattle's surprising departure from the London Symphony Orchestra, and whether it has anything to do with Britain's formal exit from the European Union. Then we'll have a movie club segment about the 1985 Maisels Brothers documentary, Ozawa. And finally, we'll home in on one particular scene from Ozawa to discuss the place of ethnic East Asians in the world of classical music today. But first, we like to start with our prelude segment. So, Kensho, what do we have today?
This week, we'll be playing a round of everyone's favorite game, Viola Hero. In the world of classical music, the viola is often overlooked and maligned, the red-headed stepchild of the string section. With this game, we seek to bring awareness to the irreplaceable value of the viola in well-known orchestral works. Here's how we will play. I heard that, Tiffany, chuckling in the background.
This introduction is so funny.
I will name a category of symphonic repertoire, then play for you a few bars of just the viola part from a famous work. I have my trusty viola with me, and my co-hosts, along with all of you at home, will try to identify the piece after hearing the excerpt. This week, there will be three categories: Mahler symphonies, Schumann symphonies, and Dvorak symphonies. How are we feeling about those categories, folks?
Well, you're covering a lot of ground here, Kensho. I mean, 9, arguably 10 Mahler symphonies, 4 Schumann symphonies, some of which exist in different versions, and then Dvorak, 9 symphonies, only 2 of which are well-known, 3 of which are medium well-known, 4 of which could be said to be slightly standard repertoire, 5 of which are basically unknown.
Yeah, so it should be easy. It's only 23 symphonies you got to cover.
Tiff, how do you feel about this?
All the parts in Mahler symphonies are very independent. So that's one of the, like, once you play one part, it's not like you know the symphony. You actually have to play the part to know it, I would think. On the other hand, the shapes are so extreme, right? So we might be able to glean something from that. Schumann, all bets are off. I mean, I have played all 4, but with the viola part, like, I'm just remembering the experience of being wiped out by Kensho's, was it Beethoven 6 last time?
Oh, yeah.
That really took it out of me. I was very demoralized.
I'm going to take my time this go-around. That's usually my tragic downfall, is that I jump in too fast. But this time I'm really going to... I'll cut out all of the interstitial silence later on.
Here is a viola part from a Mahler symphony. Tiffany looks like she knows.
You could have stopped it after the first 3 notes.
Will, are you locked in as well?
No, taking my time.
Oh, he's taking his time.
Actually, you know, I was taking my time. I was singing it through my head, and I wound up at a Shostakovich symphony, so that's very bad news.
Which one did you end up at?
Bum, 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 bum. Dun, dun, dun,
yeah, dun, I was just going to say the last movement of the 5th symphony.
Very good.
Okay, I can't say I have a good guess, but I have a guess.
All right.
Is it the 4th?
No, it's not the 4th.
Tiffany, why don't you just tell us what it is?
It's the 4th movement.
Of?
Of the 1st.
Yes, this is from the finale of Mahler's 1st symphony. All right, so the next one is going to be a viola part from a Schumann symphony.
T- Tiffany, talk through this with me. Do you feel that this was an excerpt that started in a complex meter and transitioned to a simple meter, i.e. going from a triplicate division of the beat to a duplicate?
I heard the triple division. I'm not sure I heard the transition. It felt like, I had the question mark going on, but by the time we ended, I wasn't sure that, I was convinced that that was what it was, in fact. But I agree that we're in a compound like a 6-8 or maybe a 12-8, but probably a 6-8.
What is that? What's the symphony? I think it might be Mendelssohn, where it sounds a little bit like "For He's a Jolly Good Fellow." Bum, 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 bum. Is that Mendelssohn or is that Schumann? I felt like that could be this. Do you know what I'm talking about?
But we're not talking about Mendelssohn, right? I'm now like,
no, we're talking about Schumann. Yeah,
why are you mentioning Mendelssohn?
Because
I thought that not helping you.
I am reasonably sure that this is not from 4 and or from 3.
I think that this is a scherzo movement is my best guess. Because Schumann does that a lot, like the scherzo is a triplicate feel and then the trio is a duple feel. Schumann's second symphony, that has the famous scherzo. And this isn't that. But wait.
Is there a middle section?
The middle section might be.
Do you know one? I'm actually having trouble like conjuring it.
The first symphony, the scherzo, it's bum ba da dun dun da da dun 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 da da.
Okay. Well, now I forget what the actual viola excerpt sounded like, but I scherzo of 2, is that was
that's
what
I'm
saying?
Gonna go with. I'm
all right. I'm okay with that.
All right.
You are. Correct.
Yes!
Absolutely right. Yeah, this is the second symphony of Schumann, and yes, it is the trio section of the famous scherzo.
Good teamwork, Will.
Next, we have Dvorak symphonies. Here we go.
Second movement of 7.
Yes. Right before the horn solo, yeah?
Yeah.
Correct. Great job, guys.
Whoa!
That is one of my favorite moments in that symphony because the cellos have the tune there. So everybody focuses on the cellos, but the violas have this amazing counter melody. That just about does it for this week's Prelude segment. But before we wrap up, we'd like to remind our listeners that we do periodic listener-generated Name That Tune rounds. So we invite you to try and stump us. Check our show notes where you'll find a link to the form where you can upload a 30-second unidentified piece of classical music for us to try to identify. And with that, we move on to our first topic. Tiffany, what do you have for us?
On January 9th, major news hit the highest echelon of elite symphony orchestras. Sir Simon Rattle, one of the foremost conductors in the world and current music director of the London Symphony Orchestra, has announced his plan to depart the UK to take up a post as music director of the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra, effective 2023. Rattle has applied for German citizenship and has said that his decision is primarily based on his desire to be with his wife and children who live in Berlin. For those of you who may not know, Sir Simon was music director of the Berlin Philharmonic for 17 years. This news comes just days after the formal departure of Britain from the European Union. Rattle has been clear in his public statements that his departure is not a direct consequence of Brexit, but he has also described Brexit as appalling and baffling, saying, "I wonder who could do justice to it. Would it be Lewis Carroll, Joe Orton, Salvador Dali? I mean, it's beyond surreal." To discuss this development and its wider implications for our field, we welcome back Richard Bratby of the Birmingham Post and the Classical Top 5 podcast, formerly concert manager of the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic and the City of Birmingham Symphony Orchestra, incidentally the orchestra with which Rattle established his professional reputation in the United Kingdom. Welcome back to the podcast, Richard.
Hi, great to be back.
So first impressions, I mean, what are we supposed to, you know, think apropos of this news here?
Well, it'd be crazy to say people aren't disappointed.
Yeah.
I think the hope was Rattle was going to be at least 10 years with the London Symphony Orchestra. So it started very well and with great optimism, really. I don't think anyone had seen any cracks in the relationship. In fact, I'm sure there are no cracks in the relationship. They've talked about how he's going to have this title of conductor emeritus. So clearly, there's a desire to keep that relationship going there, and there's no reason to suppose it won't continue. But I think that the hope, he was sort of the king over the water. He was going to return in triumph from Berlin and turn everything around. He'd be this great champion of classical music in the UK. He would tell the politicians what's what, get things moving in London, and you know, generally shake things up. And it's sort of, this is kind of him saying, it's not really going to happen. What, so, I mean, the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra, I mean, that is like, you know, that is the connoisseur's orchestra though, isn't it? That is, if you've done the Berlin Phil, which is well known as being supposedly the greatest orchestra in the world, there's the orchestra that actually all musicians talk about as the greatest orchestra in the world, certainly in Europe, is a Bavarian orchestra. And I mean, that's the only place you can really go. And who wouldn't? No conductor in their right mind who had a good working relationship with that orchestra would turn down an opportunity like that, I think.
Sir Simon has been clear, or has said publicly, that this is all about his family life, that his wife and kids are still based in Berlin. He wants, you know, to be able to balance his family and his professional life. But if that's the case, then why did he take the LSO job in the first place? I mean, you've got to admit there's something a little bit suspicious about this, and especially to do with the timing.
I don't know. I mean, I think certainly his contract will have come up. His initial contract will have come up about now, sort of 5 years in. They'll have been thinking about that. It's just the way the cycle of the business works. And he will have had to think hard about it. And I mean, a lot has been said about Brexit, because that's the story that gets the headlines that everyone finds sexy, for want of a better term. the reality is it's rather more, I think it's rather more boring, disappointing and convoluted political situation, specifically in London, around the plans for a new concert hall in the city. Rattle's great achievement in Birmingham, where I worked for many years, which is still talked about there, was that he not only took that orchestra onto a new level of engagement, of success, of ambition, he also got this fantastic concert hall built, modelled on the hall in Dallas by Artek, and generally regarded when it was built in 1991 as the finest acoustic in Europe. The city of Birmingham is intensely proud. It's a huge focus of civic renewal, of civic pride, of musical activity on all kinds of levels, not just classical. And I think he felt that the time was right. He could, at the end of his time in Berlin, now he would return to Britain, the coda of his career, as he sort of enters his 60s, his golden years as a conductor, you know, the grand old man period of his career. He would be able to do something in London. He would be able to give the nation's capital something just as impressive and really just as powerful a revolution. And he was given a very good reason to believe that would be the case by the government at the time, David Cameron's administration, whose chancellor, George Osborne, who is huge Wagnerite, and is now editor of the London Standard newspaper, had basically promised Rattle that they would look very seriously at getting this concert hall built. They would put the government's clout behind it. And every reason to think that within the next decade, Rattle would be sort of leading the LSO in triumph into this stunning new hall, which would become a new focus for classical music in the UK. Now, I think within about sort of 6 to 8 months of that promise being made, the government had fallen, Cameron had gone, Osborne had gone, that whole political sort of faction had left power. The new government felt very differently, and not to put too fine a point in it, basically kicked the thing into the long grass. Said, we don't think this is going to be worth doing. We don't think we can afford this. The project is still supposedly going ahead. I certainly hope it will go ahead. But what I hear is that it's got tangled up in a sort of planning hell. And if this concert hall does get built, there's no one knows yet when work might start on it. It's unlikely to be able to start before 2024, unlikely to be remotely close to completion before 2030, by which time Rattle will be in his late 70s. Mm. And, you know, if he's planning on spending his golden years sort of spearheading things of his stunning new hall, I think he's kind of realised that probably isn't going to happen now. And does he really want to spend this sort of, you know, this sort of glorious autumn of his career having political battles, fighting for funding, hustling with politicians, doing all the stuff that he did with great energy when he was a man in his 20s and 30s?
What do you make then also the fact that he is going to become a German citizen? For someone that's in the UK, is that like another extra kind of dagger that he's now leaving?
He's acquiring dual nationality, which I mean the Prime Minister Boris Johnson had dual nationality until a few years ago. It's not really a big deal in British public life. So if you're resident on the continent as a British citizen, and you're travelling very as frequently as he would be doing from one country to the next, I can see it would simplify things. It would certainly make things a lot easier under the current dispensation. I mean it's sort of safe to say that the dust has not yet settled. The Brexit settlement. I think it's quite likely, certainly there's pressure for the government to come to a deal which will make travel for musicians and artists between the EU and Britain slightly easier than it appears it's going to be at present. But that will probably take a few months to sort out, and he's probably just decided, what the hell, why should I wait in those long queues at immigration when I can just breeze straight through and get home to the wife and kids? So yeah, purely pragmatically, I see that makes a lot of sense.
So, you know, Richard, we've been scouring the British press and we've come across a lot of takes since Sir Simon has left the LSO. And one of the prominent ones is saying that, without naming any names, said that Sir Simon owes it to Britain to stay there because that's where his career was fostered by the British public. And in these hard times, he needs to show his solidarity with the British people, stay there, stay and fight for this great new concert hall and for British musical life, especially in light of the destructiveness of COVID. What do you make of that take?
I don't know. I mean, music doesn't work like that, does it? It's an international business. We all know that. You know, it'd be great. It's a bit silly. Occasionally you get people writing in saying, why are we having British conductors for British orchestras? You know, Red, White and Blue. And, you know, it's nice for British conductors work with British orchestras. It's nice when they get major gigs in Europe and the USA, as they do. Equally, in Britain, we have Mirko Gizintatila, we have Vladimir Jurovsky, we have people like that, you know, people like Mark Elder, plenty of distinguished conductors of all nationalities sort of working here and doing that leadership side of things. I mean, I think the relationship he had in Birmingham is something that it really captured the public imagination back in the 80s and 90s. And to the extent, I think most journalists in the UK who are not classical music specialists only actually know one conductor. So he's the only one they can name, I suspect. So, you know, to them, this is like classical music is leaving the room. And, you know, we know that's not the case. I think definitely, yeah, it's a disappointment. He's not sort of, it looks a bit like he's sort of leaving at an awkward time. So, yeah, there is all that. And I mean, I also think it's a bit of a guilty conscience on the part of, I mean, certain journalists need to, again, not mentioning any names. These are colleagues and friends in some cases. But there's been a lot of, I think the Australians call tall poppy syndrome about Rattle since he came back to London. Mm-hmm. The response to what he's trying to do has not been as generous as I actually think he has. I think there's a cynicism. I mean, that's part of the stock in trade of a British journalist, obviously. They like to mock. But the people who you think would be getting behind him on this concert hall particularly have been extremely lukewarm. And, you know, there's all sorts of orchestral politics going on in London. There are other orchestras who really don't want to see the LSO getting a brilliant new home and a brilliant new spotlight and have been quietly briefing away. There are journalists on the sides of those groups. There's a certain well-known commentator who keeps referring to it as Rattle's Vanity Hall Rattle's Vanity Project, which is manifestly not the case. I don't think that's how he operates. And And yeah, there's no question London needs that hall, because the two main existing orchestral halls are terrible. You know, they're kind of Lincoln Center, bad, really. If I draw a comparison there, it's they're not good. The Barbican, where the London Symphony Orchestra is based, it's a great 1970s concrete, it's a concrete masterpiece, really, brutalist masterpiece, great architecture. Terrible acoustics. I've been there. I've been at concerts. I heard Rattle conducting the Berlin Phil there. And, you know, you're hearing Rattle hearing the Berlin Phil. You want to be able to hear the horn section. You don't want the cellos to suddenly vanish from audibility if you move three seats down. That shouldn't be happening in a concert hall with the world's best orchestra and its music director, should it? And it hasn't got choir stalls. It hasn't got an organ. Basic stuff for a conductor who, you know, whose signature work is Mahler too. You know, you can see the problem, can't you? You see, he's not just being difficult here. And I think he probably fairly feels that after the amount he contributed to British musical life in his youth in Birmingham, then the remarkable achievement of being a British music director in Berlin at the top of the international orchestral profession for nearly two decades. He thinks, right, you know, at this time in life, he'd like a decent hall to do some serious work to really make the best of the years he has ahead of him. And you know, I think he's willing to wait around when he thought that was in prospect. And clearly he doesn't feel it is in prospect anymore, or at least not in the immediate future. I think that's a great pity.
So let's turn for a second, not away from Simon Rattle, but just, you know, we have a kind of, you know, desire to go to the sexy topic of Brexit. Without imposing those motives on Simon Rattle's decision, what are artists in the UK and also on the continent, I suppose, looking at as a result of Brexit? Like, what can they expect as, you know, as the fallout from the decision, or from the fallout from the actual movement comes into place? And is it so devastating? What's going on there?
Well, I think it's safe to say everyone is still working out, still trying to work out exactly what the situation is. But it was uncertainty at the moment. Britain formally left the EU nearly 12 months ago now. I mean, this is what happened on New Year's Eve was just the conclusion of the sort of parting deal. The actual formal departure had taken place. Transition phase was over. It means Britain is going to have to sort of tour Europe, essentially, worst case scenario, on the same terms as US orchestras or Chinese or non-European orchestras, basically, which is totally doable. It means a lot more work, a lot more inconvenience, certainly for orchestras. I suspect, having worked in a few orchestras, that what that means is that some poor intern who's basically 22 years old in their first job working a 50-hour week is going to find a whole pile of paperwork dumped on their desk, and they'll do it because they'll be so loyal and committed and proud of their job, and it will all go ahead fine. Paperwork is what it means, really.
What about not tour related activities? Like, will audiences, for example, be impacted at all? Like, is there a contingent of folks that regularly comes from Europe to, like, come see the orchestra? Like, what other impacts are we looking at here?
I don't really think so. I mean, it's sort of in London, certainly you've got sort of tourist economy. People travel all over the world. They go to the West End to see shows. So that's kind of been outside from one side of our world. I don't suppose there's any reason tourists will stop coming. I mean, COVID is far, far more of an impact in this case. To be honest, I suspect a lot of the sort of classical music tourism is sort of Britain to Europe rather than the other way around. There's still a train from London to Paris that takes 2 hours. It's still going to be easy to get. You might have to queue for another 10 minutes to each end, have a stamp put in a passport. I don't think that's going to really stop people. I think it's just a sort of slight jolt of things no longer being quite as they were, quite as people were used to. And for a lot of people, that seems unnecessary and unhelpful. And I mean, yeah, personally, I think I'd rather it all stayed as it was. I didn't see the need to change anything. But, you know, a debate was had, an argument was had, a vote was held, and there we are. It's a democracy.
Whenever there's a departure like this, and especially, you know, I know that this one's sort of a sad one, there is a bit of fun that comes up, because we can think about speculating who might take up the now vacant spot. So, Richard, I'm just wondering, do you have any speculations about who might become the new music director of the LSO, and or is there anybody that you would like to see become the music director of the LSO?
Well, it's a funny one, isn't it? I mean, you can sort of play these sort of games, can't you, in the abstract? And then when you look at who they're actually working with and who they actually like, I mean, they have a good relationship with Anthony Pappano at the Royal Opera House. They seem to have a really good relationship with François Xavier Roth, French conductor, but I'm not sure the audience is quite so excited by that. But certainly the orchestra seemed to really, really relish that relationship. That I mean, my golden ticket wild card in my dreams, best of all worlds, would be like, if we're going to have a British conductor, it would be John Wilson. Uh-huh. I don't know if you know his work, because he's a kind of British latter-day Andre Previn. He's a guy with feet in various worlds, you know, who can absolutely do the transition to the popular world. He makes an orchestra sound glorious. You know, orchestras like being made to sound good, and John Wilson really makes an orchestra sound good. He has all the tricks up his sleeve. He has a hankering to far more symphonic repertoire, I know, than he currently does. Whether or not they would think he was serious enough, you know, or dignified enough or old enough to be occupying this position. The LSO has quite a high opinion of itself. It receives itself without question as the number one British orchestra, a view which in Birmingham we would dispute. Nonetheless, not without foundation, some foundation. They might think he's a bit young, but you know, he also communicates as someone who really, you know, has his feet and also slightly outside of the conventional classical repertoire, as well as an absolute ability to get the great sound out of an orchestra. John Wilson would be brilliant. And Mark Elder is another possibility at the Halle Orchestra. But then there are so many candidates. I mean, it's a good job for anyone, really. And, you know, it's a plum position.
I think any of us would take it, gladly. I don't think we would turn it down.
I'm sure they'll bear that in mind. I'm sure
you heard it here first, folks. Well, this is a great story. I mean, it's been interesting teasing out all the many threads that come together in this story with, you know, the higher echelons of the conducting world and COVID and Brexit, and we'll continue to keep abreast of all those events. But thanks so much for being with us to talk about all of them today, Richard.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Okay, that just about wraps up this segment, but before we move on, just a brief reminder that next week we are going to do a book club segment on The Classical Revolution, Thoughts on New Music in the 21st Century by the Dutch composer John Borstlap. So if you care to read along with us, you can find a link to buy your own copy of the book in our show notes. Kencho, what do you have next?
It's time for another GabFest Movie Club, and today we are reviewing Ozawa, a documentary about conductor Seiji Ozawa from 1985. The film mostly takes place over a summer at the Tanglewood Music Center, the Boston Symphony Orchestra's summer home, and shows Ozawa teaching, rehearsing, and enjoying time with his family. Let's listen to a clip from the film.
34. I'm telling you for your life, music is not just melody. Music is more inside, more depth. And if you can study this summer, fantastic for your life. And you don't study this way, looking at Mr. Bernstein or Maestro von Karajan.
No.
Here, mm-hmm. and those great maestro has their own way. If you copy, dead. I saw so many young conductors. Maestro von Karajan has only he can do. Maestro Bernstein can do only he can do. You must create yourself.
Admittedly, I'm a big fan of Maestro Ozawa and have been lucky enough to be invited to conduct his Saito Kinen Orchestra in Japan. So with that disclosure aside, I can say that I loved watching this documentary. What did you guys think?
I also really enjoyed it. You know, there's something from the particular era of filmmaking where it's interesting to note that there's a couple like documentary trends that are happening now that were not around when this movie was created. And so a couple of the first observations that I have was how robust the use of like actual music footage was, and also background music, like long segments of just music. And I quite appreciated that, being as that this is a documentary about a musician without exposition. And like, I know that would make it maybe harder for some people, especially non-musicians, to get into, but I really appreciated it. I was able to really sink in and listen. And the other thing is that there was not really much of a narrator voice. It was basically all Seiji talking and his students talking. And so there's not really an expository arc to this documentary, and that made it feel somehow quite, I don't know, authentic, although that's obviously, I'm a product of the modern generation of movie watching, so...
Yeah, I'll just mention that this documentary is by the Maisels brothers, and they are most famous for a documentary called Grey Gardens about poor relations of Jacqueline Kennedy, who are living in this totally decrepit, rundown mansion in the Hamptons. And that's like a very cult classic, and a musical was made of it. And so probably some of our listeners would have known that. I don't know. But yeah, I think this is a really good documentary. it is a little bit weird. Like there's part of it where they're rehearsing. Seiji Ozawa is rehearsing the Boston Symphony with the pianist Rudolf Serkin, and like you can tell that the camera is just right up in everybody's grill. Like, you know, he's like sort of creeping around the podium, and you can see the camera, the different angles as he moves, and he's like right in Seiji's face, he's right in the concertmaster's face, he's right in Serkin's face. But no, I like the big long tracks of music too. That was something I took note of. And I think it's pretty good.
And like the pairing of the music, right? Like I thought, like if there was background music, they would sync it up really well too, in terms of like when a new, like not character, but when another figure of Ozawa's life is like introduced, they pair it with a certain moment in music. And I thought it was really smartly done. Did you also catch the producer credit for this film?
No, who was it?
Peter Gelb.
Oh, interesting. Peter Gelb,
wow.
Famous bête noir of the classical Gabfest.
Yeah, so it's like one of the first names that comes up in the credits of the film. And I was like, oh my God, like he's everywhere.
Well, we should say he's currently the intendant, the executive director, CEO, president, whatever you will, of the Metropolitan Opera, the guy who's been making all of these rather unpleasant decisions that we've been talking about.
Well, we all have participated in conducting summer camps. And there's kind of an extended thread through this documentary of Ozawa teaching his students at Tanglewood. And they show some of these kind of rehearsal and teaching sessions that Ozawa had. Did that kind of flash you back to our own experiences? Like I was kind of remembering like how scary those moments were when you had like a big maestro next to you and like you trying to just figure out how it all works in terms of the conducting part.
Yeah, I mean, especially there was that one young Japanese conductor who Ozawa given a pretty hard time to, and like was very public about it. Like every time that the guy would do something wrong, he would turn to the rest of the conductors or turn to the cameras and say like, he's having a really hard time. You know, he just can't do this. He can't figure it out. I was like, damn, Seiji.
That's not how I interpreted that line, actually.
Oh, really? How did you interpret it?
Yeah, it was more like he's having a hard time, like, give him a break. Like, don't think that you're so hot and you can do it better, which is conductors are very guilty of when we're sitting in the back of a masterclass all lined up and looking at the person on the podium and wishing that we were there and thinking we could do it better. Don't get ahead of yourself. Like, yeah, he's having a hard time. Like, you know, and I think that, I mean, yeah, he's hard on him, but it's not like he's telling it as he sees it. It's not saying to everybody else he can't do it because whatever, you know. And I think that his teaching philosophy does come through in a number of very nice points. I mean, it's clear that he does feel some sense of responsibility for the development of this young conductor. Who, do we know who that is?
Like, no,
do,
I was wondering.
I tried to find out, actually. Yeah. I didn't know whether this person had ended up becoming somebody.
Wait, I Kencho, I had a question for you, because we'll link in the show notes the YouTube video that we watched, because this has been uploaded in its entirety. It's an hour-long documentary. But the upload is from when it was broadcast on Japanese television. So there are subtitles in Japanese. The documentary is mostly in English. But of course, when Ozawa is interacting with this one Japanese conducting student, there's a long part where they have a heart-to-heart talk in Japanese. And Kencho, I was wondering if you could shed any light on what Ozawa was actually saying in that moment.
Yeah, it actually deals really closely to what we were just talking about in terms of kind of his teaching philosophy. I know like later on in the film, he talks about how Karayan was such a big mentor to him and that he, you know, wishes that he could do that for a younger conductor in the future. And so you kind of see him, the elements of that kind of mentorship with this young student. And I think it was right after that session in which that young student was having a quote unquote hard time. And then I think there's a scene in his car where he's like, yeah, like, I think, he, you know, he's having a hard time. I should probably invite him for a drink and have some food and then just talk to him, you know, face to face, because I feel responsible for bringing him to Tanglewood. And that, you know, he felt clearly, like Tiffany said, like a responsibility for this student. Right. So that the scene is that they sit him down. And I think one of the first things that Seiji says is kind of like, I can also be pretty short tempered. You know, so, you know, like he doesn't really necessarily apologize for his like being hard on this guy, but he was kind of explaining it that way. And then he says something about being a lone wolf, that conducting is very much like a lone wolf thing, and that you need to have like conviction in your heart and the strength to kind of withstand the ups and downs of the challenges of conducting. And I think at some point he even references, and this is a part I had a hard time catching what he was saying. But he was saying something like, in Japan, they feel like I think I am the big time, that like I'm too pompous now, and so they're not kind to me in Japan, but you have to be strong enough to kind of like push through that and be your own person and know your own convictions or something like that. So he's not necessarily, I expected that conversation to be a little bit softer in tone, but he actually in a way like doubles down and just basically says like, you need to be strong and like you need to like overcome this challenge to be a conductor in this world. And I can't say I disagree with that sentiment.
Well, and at that era, I would say it's like absolutely part of the texture of the world, right? I mean, and even if you think about it now, like conductors, you know, 100 spots for 10,000 people who think that they can get in front of an orchestra and wave their hands. Why, you know, to take a kind of capitalist angle on it, like, why would you go around, like, you know, developing all 10,000 of them for all except for, you know, 100 of them to do what? To do what? And so that is the sort of mentality that leads to this tough love approach in some ways. And it's not unjustified.
But also just like, I wonder if there, you know, are non-conductor and also maybe non-musician listeners that that follow us, I wonder how they reacted to those scenes where Ozawa was teaching. Because for me, having undergone some pretty tough love myself, that seemed pretty mild. But I wonder how it comes off to someone that hasn't seen that kind of scenario before. Because it's also a very weird thing, right? You think that conducting, you study in front of, you know, at least a score or an orchestra, but suddenly you're in this room with a pianist, and then there's 20 of your colleagues watching you, and just a podium and a stand, and you're conducting, and the pianist is kind of following you, but maybe not. It's just kind of a really artificial situation that you find yourself in the first place. So I wonder how people see that scene. You know?
Yeah, and I'm sure you both have had interactions. Forgive us, listeners. We try not to geek out about conducting and the inside world, but you know, occasionally it's fun to kind of lift the flap back. And what I will say in this forum is that I've also had circumstances where I will have gone through a lesson on the podium, and it will be, I'm not going to call myself thick-skinned or anything, but it will feel to me like more or less a normal lesson. And then somebody, you know, maybe in the orchestra or somebody who was just watching or somebody who saw a video afterwards would be like, wow, that was pretty tough, huh? And I'll be like, it was fine. It was just normal, you know?
Right.
And, you know, and then obviously I've also been through lessons where, yeah, it was a tough time. You know, I'm not going to pretend that that doesn't happen. But you do have to have a certain tolerance because all the learning is public learning. It just is with this art form.
Really quick, because Kencho, you mentioned, you talked about the carry-on moment. And that is like the funniest part of this whole thing, is that Herbert von Karajan, you know, we're talking about the upper echelons of the music business and former music directors of the Berlin Philharmonic. Karajan has this cameo where he has like a 5-minute conversation with Ozawa on the tarmac before getting onto a private plane to zip off and conduct somewhere else. And Ozawa's just like, you know, I'm going to conduct Eugene Onegin in Milan. Do you think that sounds like a good idea? And Karajan's just like, oh, yes, who is going to be in it? He's like, oh, yes, this seems like a fine idea. And then he's off. It's like, what do you make of that moment?
I don't know. That was a weird flex, too. Like, just the fact that he's like, oh, yeah, I'll appear in this documentary. Meet me at the tarmac for my private jet.
Yes. Right.
We'll film the scene there. I don't know.
I mean, I think that scene and, you know, another scene, which we'll discuss in a little bit, like, there's several scenes that are obviously not scripted. And it's just interesting, right? I mean, obviously, they just wanted his face to be in there. And, you know, probably, I don't know what the filmmakers had in mind. You know, maybe they were hoping that there would be some, like, meaningful exchange with conducting wisdom, blah, 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 blah. But connecting between, like, in this fashion and in that place, obviously, is often just made up of these little things. I mean, what he ends up saying is like, oh yeah, let me know when, I'll try and see if I can come, you know? So, and that's the sort of thing that like, that careers happen off of, you know, that's the down and the dirty. So I think that's why it got included. I don't know, it's interesting to think about the editing choices and what a lot of things that I think in modern day documentary making might have ended up on the cutting room floor are in here, which I love. I find incredibly refreshing.
I think that takes us comfortably into one scene that stayed in and that we're going to devote or use as a pivot point to our next segment.
Yeah, okay, so well, let's move on to our third segment, which kind of is connected to this, obviously. So, Will, why don't you talk us through this particular scene in the film?
All right, so Ozawa is seated at a picnic table with Yo-Yo Ma, the great cellist, and they are discussing the problem of being an Oriental, to use Ozawa's word, in Western classical music. Now, we've heard Ozawa discuss how he's not Western enough for the Westerners and not Japanese enough for the Japanese, and that tension is a key point in this whole documentary. But here he gets really serious and he actually tells the cameras to stop recording. So let's listen to that clip.
2 years.
I'm trying to think.
Remember that discussion about whether an Oriental can do Western music?
Oh, God. Music can be learned really by anybody who cares to know it well enough and deeply enough, and given the talent, they can do it. I know from my own family, which is very Oriental.
Yeah?
Very, extremely Oriental. And I know from visiting Japan or going to into an Oriental culture, and you feel, I know exactly why people act the way they do. Conforming there is more important than being an individual. That becomes hard when you have a talent.
That's right.
But when I'm outside of an Oriental culture, you have to speak up. You have to say that, you know, I have an opinion. But when I'm in the Orient, I'm not supposed to have an opinion because
that's,
well, I try to respect, you know, the
can
differences.
You do that? This question is very serious to me.
Mm-hmm. That's.
Mm-hmm. I hope you're not. This is very private. Oh, yeah. Very private.
Okay, we'll stop the camera.
All right, now I should add that we wanted to dissect this particular conversation in this moment, partially because we're talking about the documentary, but it's actually partially because of something that came up on our podcast last week when we were talking about the Institute for Composer Diversity. Now, a little peek behind the curtain, in her original outro to that segment, Tiffany had said that none of us fall into the categories that would be covered by this institute. But I ended up cutting that out because, in point of fact, the Institute for Composer Diversity says that it's there to amplify the voices of people of color, not specifying that it's BIPOC people. So that would be Black and Indigenous people of color. So therefore, Kensho and Tiffany, and in fact our guest that week, John Hong, would indeed be covered by the Institute. So let's take this scene as a jumping off point. What did you think about this? And when Ozawa got so, he said that this was such a personal moment that it couldn't, that it was private. He didn't want this to be on camera. What did you think about where the conversation was and where do you think it might have been going?
Well, let's clarify why we thought that this was an interesting topic worthy of an entire segment. As Will just said, it came apropos of, you know, this documentary and our conversation last week, and of course Kensho and my identities as Ishes and Show. We're trying to pick apart what is the place of being East Asian, specifically, in the classical music world. And that is a topic worthy of discussion because of, well, you know, during the time when this conversation was taking place, the initiating question was, why would you want to play Western music as an East Asian? Or can an East Asian successfully play Western classical music? That's the angle they were coming from. Now that question seems a little dated in some ways, right? I mean, and it's because of the phenomenal success that East Asians have found both abroad and in importing that art form to China and Japan and Korea. And so the question that I'm asking myself every day is, what is my role vis-a-vis the social justice movement in our world as an East Asian? And the reason that my original outro, as Will described it, the reason I phrased it this way was because I know from my heart of hearts that I have occupied a place of privilege in this field. That's what my experience lines up with. I know this from my upbringing. Whether you want to call that an outgrowth of my racial identity or not, I know this. So that's why I find this topic is really personally important to me.
Yeah, absolutely. And maybe to just bring it back to the film too, for me, like, I think the moment at which I think Seiji tells the cameras to stop recording is when he is kind of questioning Yo-Yo Ma's ability to, I think he's saying, he's asking Yo-Yo Ma, like, are you able to kind of like, you know, really code switch, right? Like code switch between being a Western, you know, when he's in the Western part of the world, he can be outspoken and he can be himself. But then, you know, Yo-Yo's kind of saying like, well, if I go back to China, I absolutely have to like conform and, you know, try to fit in as much as I can, or kind of mute.
Right, by which he means not speaking out as much. And then Ozawa gets very flustered. He's like, can you actually do that?
Right.
Can you do that? And then he realizes, you're not still recording this, are you? And then he kind of looks around and he realizes that they are recording it. And then he tells him not to.
Yeah. And so I related very much to the experience because, you know, being born in Japan and moving to the States when I was five and growing up in perhaps the whitest place you could ever grow up in, Greenwich, Connecticut. I think at a very early age, I don't think it was a conscious thing, and I don't think that I was ever was told by my parents or something at all. But, you know, I definitely conformed to my surroundings as a young kid surrounded by white people. And so now as I've started to work in Japan and go back and conduct Japanese orchestras, I've had to kind of relearn the culture there in a way and try to also then fit in, right? And I feel I think I'm still trying to figure out who I am as an artist, if I am, you know, identify as an Asian American. So, you know, when I go back to Japan, it's not necessarily like I feel like I'm Japanese going home, but rather like I'm an American that doesn't quite fit in Japan either, right? So my place as an artist, or like kind of where I fall into the spectrum of social justice and all this, to me, like when I look at the, and I think for a lot of people, right, they look at the stages and they see so many Asian musicians on stage, they're thinking, well, there's no issue here with, you know, lack of representation on stage. But then when I think, and I think this is why I think I've watched this documentary about Ozawa so intently as well, is that there are not that many conductors that are of Asian heritage on stage. We're looking at diversity in that sense. So I look at the stage and I say, well, yeah, there's no problem here about representation in the Asian community. But as an Asian conductor, I'm thinking, where do I fall in that? And should I be advocating for more of that representation on stage when clearly there are many more kind of more important issues about social injustice that I think Asians don't face in this country, right? So this is where the conflict is within myself.
So Kencho, yeah, I agree, especially about conductors and also composers, which is something that I want to talk about too. But before we move on to that, I just want to ask you about a detail. This is something that we've talked about a little bit off mic, and something that I've just asked out of curiosity is, when you are in Japan conducting, you have experimented with rehearsing in Japanese, but have sort of defaulted to English, strangely enough. Can you tell the listeners why you've made that decision? It's super interesting to me.
Yeah, I mean, there are many factors in this decision. One is the fact that I am way more comfortable speaking English than I do Japanese. Probably that's the first reason. I moved when I was five. I, you know, think, dream, you know, count in English in my head. Like everything is English up here. And now that, you know, I'm learning French, it's a little bit more of a conflict up there, but we won't get into that today. The other part is that the Japanese language, for those that are not familiar, have many endings and conjugations. And there's a whole different way of speaking when you are speaking to someone that is older than you, that someone that is more experienced than you are, someone that is in a higher position in a company than you are. And these rules are woven into the social construct of the country, and it still is today. And the way those endings or conjugations or the way of speech that you do for those kind of older people or more experienced people, it kind of gets in the way of the role of the conductor. Because if I were to translate, let's say if I was working with an American orchestra and I just say, oh, you know, X instrument group, so I don't call out any of our musicians here, but, you know, X instrument group, you're just a hair behind. We just need to play a little bit more on top of the beat. Like, instead of falling behind, let's be a little bit more ahead. And so, you know, whatever. The translation of that, if I were to use this kind of respectful language, would be kind of like, well, if you wouldn't mind making this big adjustment, you know, I'm hearing you know, that you are just slightly behind. And if you, again, you know, I really don't want to bother you, but, you know, sorry to be so bothersome, but if you could please, you know, be a little bit ahead of the beat, I would really appreciate it. Thank you so much. And, you know, and of course I'm exaggerating a little bit, but you can see how this language would be incredibly inefficient for a rehearsal when you have such little time. And as a young conductor in his 30s, most of the musicians in that orchestra are going to be more experienced and older than I am. And so I've felt like I could be a more effective conductor if I speak English and don't have to worry about those things. And it's not like I am being disrespectful in my English language when asking for these things. There's an element of decorum when you are rehearsing in English as well. So I felt empowered for this decision because I am an American, right? That I, you know, even though I look Japanese, I identify as an American. I've done 99.9% of my schooling in the States. So there's, I mean, what is the difference between me going in there and doing rehearsals in English than any other white person that grows up in American schools and going there and rehearsing in English as well?
Right. It's like how if I were to go rehearse in Britain, I have committed myself to not learning what a crotchet is or a minim or a semi-demi-hemi-quaver. Sorry, Richard Bratby and your colleagues.
Well, it's funny that you say that because I actually do study up on that before going to work with the UK orchestra. So I'm trying to assimilate there as much as I can, I guess.
So, Tiffany, let's get back to this question of representation, because obviously it has changed. As you say, Ozawa's question, it seems pretty dated coming from 1985, especially because if you were to look at the Boston Symphony now, you would see quite a few people of East Asian descent, whether they are coming from Asia or raised in Europe or the United States. But we were talking last week about the composer diversity database. And as Kencho was saying, you don't see so many Asian conductors, at least not in Europe or North America. And I feel like you really don't hear many Asian composers, and certainly not in comparison to how many there are. I mean, I know a lot of Asian composers, and, you know, I don't feel like they are represented. So what is it about that where Asian people have such success getting into the top orchestral positions? And it might even be worth breaking down that down more, because really, Asian people have a lot of success getting into the string sections of orchestras. You don't see so many Asian peoples in woodwinds and brass and percussion sections versus these quote-unquote more creative or authoritative roles of composer and conductor.
There's so many threads to untangle here, and there's inevitably going to be something that will come across as a stereotype and probably in what I say, right? I mean, you can talk about, to attack one of what I think is kind of one of the easier questions that you just asked. I mean, I think that there are more Asians in piano and violin positions and cello positions, and not maybe not so much violas. I mean, definitely they're there, but I'm not sure that I know that many Asian basses. So we're really talking about instruments that have like a visible profile and a soloist cachet attached to them. That's really what we're talking about here. And I think that that's not, that will come across as a little bit stereotypy, but I think is well supported by the numbers in Chinese conservatories. So that carries over to, obviously, Asian Americans growing up here. We all took piano and violin growing up. I am the stereotype. It's me. So I think that that's a reasonable... I mean, these are the instruments with a lot of prestige and symbolism attached to them. To talk about composers, and I'm not sure I agree anymore about the conductor thing. I'm seeing quite a lot of them now. I'm not sure I agree there anymore. Like, female and male, in fact. And a lot of them are of my generation or slightly above, right? I mean, it's like, I feel like there's a wave that's happening right now. And so it no longer feels as if I'm sort of operating in an environment of where I don't have the, see the representation and thus feel isolated in some way. Like, that's not a feeling that is in my experience personally.
And certainly in major superstar soloists, I think we can point to a lot of Asians.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to think about the composer question, because you're right. Like, I, for some reason, there's very few. I mean, I can think of like three off the top of my head in terms of like Asian composers, East Asian composers that are in the limelight. And it's not clear to me exactly why. I mean, I have a feeling that as the classical music tradition is manifestly European, and by the way, much of East Asia's fascination with it comes from its manifest Europeanness, which is a cultural status symbol, it can feel a little bit perhaps disingenuous for somebody to say, oh, I'm going to compose in the style of Beethoven from my, you know, Chinese perspective or what have you. I have to guess, although I don't compose and I don't, you know East Asian composers, I have to guess that that is something that might be happening there. There's also this sense of, like, you do have to be creative to be a composer, and I would not say that China has a great history of celebrating creative individualism. I mean, the mold of raising performers is different, really different from that. This idea where you come up with your ideas as a person. I mean, there, we have a track record, in fact, of like group composition, which is this very own weird animal, and harkens back to, you know, communist China, like Red China era kind of projects, like the Yellow River Piano Concerto. But I do think that there's just not as much of a status attached to, or this like romance attached to, this rugged individualism where you're on your own and you're lonely by yourself in your room, like scribbling down mad ideas. Like, that's for, you know, history, and like our, what we do now is we play the music, and we play it at an incredibly high level.
I mean, I guess a question for either or both of you is, you know, the thing about a composer diversity database, just to go back to that a little bit now, is it does preference these visibility issues over other things. And I think that the tension that we're getting to here is a tension between racial representation and gatekeeping based on class. And I think that what you don't see happening in the classical music world is people from outside of the privileged classes making a great success in our world. And I'm going to link in the show notes, and I would really recommend that our listeners check out an essay by a writer named Kate Wagner, better known as McMansion Hell. She mainly writes about architecture, but her article is called The Meritocratic Failures of Classical Music. And it's her life story talking about how when she was a young white girl growing up in rural North Carolina, she was the head of her class of her violin studio, thought that she had a great career ahead of her, but she did not have the money or the class sense of what it would mean to pursue an elite classical music education. She just, you know, didn't have the information that you would need to even know what you would need to do to go into that. And so I think that class gets very intermingled with this question of East Asian representation in classical music, because Tiffany, as you said, you feel that you yourself were coming from a place of privilege, relatively speaking.
Can I hearken back to a line that actually I wish I had brought up in our previous segment from the documentary, which is very close to the beginning of the documentary, which in which Ozawa says, I was just lucky. I was just lucky to pick up this and that. And like, it was all luck. And I think that is very closely tied because, well, you picked up on what I was saying about how the question of can East Asians perform classical music viably sounds kind of dated, but let's admit that these are questions that people who don't have access to the resources to study this art form are still asking. And really the question right now is, can I study this art form if I am poor? Mm-hmm. That is the real question. And because the intersection of poverty and blackness in this country is way more than it should be, that is the question that many black musicians have to ask of themselves. So it's not a dated question at all in this sense, right?
I think we can all agree that there's an incredible amount of class gatekeeping that goes on in classical music. I mean, just looking at the cost of, you know, private lessons, when you're talking about not knowing how to enter an elite elite university or elite conservatory for music. I mean, the application fees alone, or the audition fees, or the lesson fees. I mean, getting your instrument. They're just things that are cost prohibitive that our world on a whole has not really addressed on a grand scale. I can point to a number of wonderful organizations that are trying to make this an easier road for people. But, I mean, there's still an incredible amount of gatekeeping there, just evidenced by, you know, the racial diversity in the top conservatories and universities.
And then you get into these situations where you're in youth orchestra and people are talking about, well, half of the people in here are Asian. What is our responsibility now? I mean, of course, apropos of all the events of last year and many, many more prior to the last year, done a lot of reading and kind of reckoning vis-a-vis my own race and how in this field and in this profession, from my point of view and my upbringing, my role is that of an ally in this particular fight, you know. And I think that was the truest form which led me to say my outro last week originally as I had, which is that I couldn't submit my name credibly to the Composer Diversity Project and be like, promote me. I couldn't do it.
Exactly. I think I am absolutely, yeah, an ally, but certainly not in the group of people that are experiencing these hardships in the same way, right? Like that I'm there to support and amplify voices that are obviously not being heard, but I certainly would not consider myself just as underprivileged so that I deserve the benefits of those initiatives in any way.
Yeah, and, you know, obviously we've just done this kind of segment which essentially centers Kensho in my experiences, but we do our best to center voices that we feel like have been, you know, underrepresented on this podcast. And I think Will does an excellent job of kind of helping us, you know, curate the material that ends up on this podcast. But I don't know, listeners, this is very personal for me, so help us be the best that we can be.
Well, I can't think of a better note to end this on. I mean, this has been a great segment, guys. And thank you both for sharing so much personal of your experiences, because we don't often do that on this show. You know, we sort of talk about news.
Yeah, that's not what we're trying to do here.
Yeah, exactly. If you're a first-time listener, it's not always like, you know, the therapy couch at the Classical Gabfest. But this was a really important thing to talk about, I think. So thank you to both of you. And listeners, this is definitely one where we would love to hear your feedback. All right, with that, it's time, I believe, for our classical mixtape.
In our classical mixtape, we each recommend some music that's caught our ear this week to share with our listeners. So, Will, what do you have this week?
Well, I have chosen you won't believe it, an Asian composer. This is a Japanese composer named Ryuichi Sakamoto, and the name of the piece is M.A.Y. in the Backyard. This piece originally from the soundtrack to Call Me By Your Name, so I'm sure that many of our listeners will be familiar with it. Although all of my film friends keep trying to tell me that Call Me By Your Name is actually not a famous movie and that Timothée Chalamet is not actually a big movie star, but I disagree.
What?
I know, it's crazy. But anyway, that's a great soundtrack overall, and this is one of my favorite cuts from it.
Nice.
Yeah, that's excellent. Thanks, Will. Kensho, you're up next.
Well, I'm starting up a new semester at Temple University, and as we're finding repertoire for a chamber orchestra size, because that's the limit in terms of the social distancing and all the plexiglass that's on the stage, and came across Francis Poulenc's Symphonietta pour Orchestre. And it's prototypical Poulenc in the witty harmonies and the great energy that there is in this piece. And this particular recording is conducted by an Ozawa disciple, actually, Natalie Stutzmann, and Swedish Chamber Orchestra. Thank you.
Thanks, Kensho. So for today, I went through my, you know, Ozawa recording. I wouldn't say that I have like a robust knowledge of his recording history, but I do have a few recordings that I really associate with him. And one of them is his Daphnis and Chloe Suite number 2. This was maybe the first piece I got to help out with as like a baby conductor in my master's program. I got to conduct the offstage chorus. So it also has a particular, you know, weight for me. And then of course I conducted it as part of my graduation proceedings for my doctoral at University of Maryland. So kind of full circle with that piece for me. You'll find the links to all these and to our full classical mixtape playlist in the show notes.
And with that, it's time to wrap up this episode of the Classical Gabfest. I'm William White, and on behalf of Tiffany Liu and Kensho Watanabe, I'd like to thank you so much for listening and to encourage you to subscribe and rate us on Apple Podcasts. We'd also love your help spreading the word about the show on social media, where you can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can reach us at classicalgabfest@gmail.com, and we would love to hear from you. Until next time, happy listening, and we'll be with you next week.